now with this drive, we know they're out there like that, but back then we didn't know, but we kind of thought, right? They're out there, right? Yeah.
Yeah, totally.
So I'm looking forward to this new Halloween movie.
Right? Yeah.
It's going to be great, yeah.
It's going to be brutal. All right, so who's going to be the brave first one with the question? There you go, front row.
Any chance you would get back into comedy?
I'm going to San Antonio next week and doing stand-up comedy next week, yeah.
Oh, God.
Where is that? Where am I at?
Ha Ha Comedy.
Ha Ha Comedy Club. I think it's Ha Ha with for HBO Max, yeah. Yeah, so yeah.
Oh, cool.
I do like two shows a year. You know?
Oh, sweet.
Road trip, anybody?
Yeah. We live right by San Antonio.
Yeah.
We live right by San Antonio.
You gotta go.
That's my hometown. That's my hometown, yeah.
Oh, that's so cool. All right, we've got another good one right here.
Okay, we saw you were on ER. What was it like, and were you a patient?
What is that?
ER, the TV show.
Yeah, that was did you understand what was going on there? You see, I had a wife in the show. It was a very emotional scene. And that's one job where I learned don't cry at all during rehearsal. Because I was crying my ass off during rehearsal, and when I said action, I couldn't cry no more. You know what I'm saying? That's why you see me banging my head on the damn thing. I was trying to rehearse. But anyway, what happened is my wife, I was supposed to give her on the pills. It says, give it to her once a day. But I was only Spanish-speaking Mexican, and I didn't know how to read. So once in Spanish, it sounds once, which means 11. So I was giving my wife 11 pills a day. And I killed her. It's a great episode, man. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And then they say, he goes, once in, I told them, they told me 11, and they go, no, it's once a day. And I didn't OD my wife. Very sad episode, yeah. Great episode, yeah.
Yeah, wow.
And honest mistake.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we're sisters.
But
what season was it?
I don't even know. It's a long time ago.
I think that the always correct IMDb might be able to tell us. We never know.
Except my age. Never right.
Yeah. All right. And who's got another good one here?
All right, go ahead. What's one of your favorite X-Files and Z-Nation?
Favorite X-Files and Z-Nation?
Well, I got to do X-Files. It has to be the one I was in for sure. I got my hands cut off, and it was cool because they were very expensive hands because they were made out of my hands. And then so when they were done with them, they actually let me keep them. So you best believe that Halloween I was giving away candy with no hands. You know what I mean? I love that stuff. Yeah, and what was it? Z Nation. Anytime I was killing a zombie, I'm a zombie guy. I've always loved zombies since the Night of the Living Dead, since I was a kid. Scared the shit out of me. But it was funny because I spent two summers in Spokane, Washington, filming that show, and so sometimes you work 12, 14 hours and you're kind of tired, and we're in the middle of the woods, so sometimes I'd be in my chair drinking a coffee, and then all of a sudden you see like this green thing passing by in the woods. Like, what the fuck is that? You know what I mean? And it was a zombie, but of course we're doing a zombie show. You know what I mean? It's kind of taking back sometimes. You know what I mean? That's when it's getting dust. You know?
Just wandering.
Yeah,
by.
Goodness.
Yes, sir.
What's your favorite motorcycle to ride?
It depends on what I'm riding. I have quite a few bikes, bro. So it depends how I'm riding or what I'm riding. If I know I'm gonna be in traffic, all my bikes have ape hangers, except for one that have bikini bars. But when I know I need to beat traffic, I have one that's really, really high, so I can pull by without hitting the mirrors, So my deluxe is pretty cool, But they're all, even though they're, I'm a fool, bro. Even though they come comfortable, I'm more for the look. So mine look really rowdy, and they're not comfortable at all, but they look cool, I remember I rode over to New Mexico, and I had like a 1-inch of pyrocine on me, the bare bones, to New Mexico from California, bro. It was cool running with the group, but I had to come back with myself because I had an audition the day earlier, and running back to the Arizona desert, 112 degrees by yourself is ugly. Because at least when you're running with your friends, you're racing, open road, just like having fun, right? Coming back, it was brutal, bro. Sometimes I just wanted to let go, terrible, man. Right on, good question.
I love that. You were doing some photos earlier with Danny Trejo.
Yeah.
And I know there's some good stories there. You got one that you can tell here, a good Danny story?
I got a lot of Danny Trejo stories. I love Danny. Danny is, when I got in the business, it was only me and Danny Trejo that were the real guys from the streets, So that's why me and Danny always worked, because the guys that played us, the actors that played us, really sucked at it, you know what I'm saying? So me and Danny came in and we ran Hollywood. I mean, the word got around who we were, and and we couldn't stop working. But this is what the thing is with Danny, is that, you know, Danny's a real deal, you get what I'm saying? And Danny is the nicest cat you're going to meet, but you don't fuck with Danny, you know what I'm saying? and he's always been a guy who I looked up to, who I could always go to for advice. You know, because sometimes we didn't get treated right because of the roles we play. And I'll say, Danny, you know, how are you treating me? He goes, they could treat me better, you know? And as years go on, I go, how are they treating you? Danny goes, better, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? And the thing is, I remember one time we were doing Con Air together. We were together like 3 months in Con Air. And they were playing pranks. There were some pranksters on there, right? Okay. You know? And there was this, what they did, it was in the middle of the desert, you know, everywhere we were at. And they had this big tarp right in the middle. And they would have a person go in the middle of the tarp and asking like stupid questions, right? But they didn't know that this part of the tarp, they'd get a bottle of water and they would pour it here. Now, by the time he got over there, it would just drench the person in the middle, right? And they were stupid enough to go get Danny Trejo and try to prank him.
Oh, no.
We're on a break, right? So I go over there, they go, hey, Lefty, Emilio, come check this out. We're going to get Danny. I go, no, don't do Danny. So by that time, the water's already coming. It takes about 2 minutes to get there, right? So Danny's just got his little break, hit a little bowl of spaghetti.
Oh, no.
And now the next guy that's going to be up next, he's up with a white t-shirt. And he's set up, he don't know what's happening. He don't know that he's pranking Danny. So he goes, hey Danny, he's asking him some stupid question. And Danny's always, you know, a good listener. He's wild. He goes, what's up? And then so but I tell you, Danny, well, you know, and then he goes, the water falls on Danny's hair. Greg doesn't know that he was doing this to Danny. And all of a sudden, Danny, I just automatically, he gets his bowl of spaghetti and throws it all over. Brand new white shirt. And he's up next. You gotta understand, it's a big thing because you gotta go to wardrobe shit. Yeah. But that's what, just like automatic goes, was what? I got a lot more Danny stories. Let me tell you, we got time, I got Danny stories.
Yeah.
One of the best guys you're ever gonna be. The best in the business.
Got lucky to only got spaghetti on.
I know.
All right, who's got another good question here? All right, in the back.
You know, brother, I'm a street guy. I was gang leader pretty much all my life, you know what I'm saying? And all I did was just move my Marcus office is Emilio Rivera 30 years ago, you know what I'm saying? So it's pretty easy to get there, you know. It's just I was street related, gang related, lowrider related, and I've always had bikes. And I know a lot of MCs, I mean, because they're you know, part of the hood. We don't bang with each other because we're totally different, two different things, but we recognize each other. So yeah, so it was kind of easy to get to Alvarez, you know, very easy. Yeah, kind of the easiest characters I ever played, you know.
Yeah, but they got something wrong on the show, did you tell them?
There's things I won't do, I won't say. The thing is, Kurt Sutter, you know, he's very strong with his words. If you write something, it cannot be changed. But I always had that little thing on the side that I wouldn't say this, I wouldn't say that. So you say, what would you say? And I would say it, and he would say, we'll write that in. And so out of respect, he would respect that, and that's cool. You know what I'm saying? You know, as any good director or producer should, you know what I'm saying? Because you don't want to get in trouble with other people. You don't want to piss nobody, you don't want to raise nobody's eyebrows, you know what I mean? You know what it is, disrespect, man, you know?
Yeah, oh, I love that, that's good.
Yeah, and you see some people, I see some movies and I say, how did they get away with that? And then later on you find out that they didn't get away with it, you know? So.
Yeah, you gotta be careful. All right. I saw another hand back over here. Or somebody scratching. Maybe. Actually, you know, about Kurt though, I did want to ask. He is an interesting guy, and not at all what you think he would be, kind of like Rob Zombie, you know, in a way that that's a different person than you think that story comes out of, right?
Kurt is a good friend of mine. Mm-hmm. Kurt is he's had my back. He's been my corner. Great guy. Totally opposite what you read and stuff like that, man. You know, we all got a little bad. We could all have a bad day here and there, you know. But solid guy. You know, if he's your friend, he's your friend. You dig what I'm saying? And some of us are not all friends. You know what I mean? So, yeah. Great guy, man. Great guy.
Yeah. Is there a time on the set that just is there a certain day that just always stands out in your mind? Like if someone asks you 20 years from now about either of those shows, is there something that just, oh man, this was a really good day?
You know, a good day could be a bad day, or you know, vice versa. I've had days where it was very emotional, and those are the ones I remember most. You know, because I try, you know, I paced strong so much, so the days that knocked me down a little bit, I remember, like when I killed my son on the show, when I had Happy kill my son, that was a very emotional day, because I called my real son, I said, hey, I'm going to do something right now, but I want you to know that I would never kill you in real life, you know? and he goes, yeah, I know that, Dad, I know that. but it was just the moment that we had there, and right before, right, and then we weren't even shooting that scene, we were shooting something else. But I started breaking down, and I go, we gotta shoot this shit now, bro, you know, and no, we're doing that, but no, we're doing this now. So they all came running with the cameras, man. That was like a one take thing, you know what I'm saying? And it was very, very touching. It was like, just enough, you know, because I was aiming out a lot more, you know. They knew how to cut it, because I broke down that day. So yeah. That stuff that I remember, you know.
Yeah, well, and I know you've got a bunch of great stuff coming out. I think, you know, IMDb and never know, but I think there's like 9 things listed that are coming up.
Yeah, I've been blessed, man. You know what? It was kind of tough looking with COVID. You know, they knocked us down for about 9 months. And, well, you know, there was a work. The work was already waiting there, you know, and I just waited for them to say it's okay to go back. So, yeah, you know, since we've opened up, we haven't stopped. You know, since we finished Mines of last year, I've been blessed and been busy.
I love that. Is there anything in particular coming up that we should know about that you're really excited about?
Yeah, a few things. I just did this movie. The guy that invented the hot Cheetos. Everybody knows hot Cheetos, right? Yeah. I just came back from Mexico, New Mexico, and we did his life story. And I played his father for 35 years, so I go through this transformation of 35 years. You know what I'm saying? So that's pretty badass. You know what? You know, it was kind of tough. You know, 3 in the morning, putting on wigs and shit. You know what I'm saying? It was tough. I feel bad for people who have to do it every day, you know. And then I got that coming out, and then I have a show called The Family Business. We come back next month. It's a series. The lady that plays my wife is my real wife in real life. So that's kind of, that's always kind of cool. You know, I get to beat her up and do it. That's good. And then I have I don't know if you're watching the show called On My Block. We're coming back for our last season next month, October 4th. And then I have another show called The Brothers Garcia. I think we're coming out late October. And then there's another show, and I forget what it is. You know, but
it's
Is that Brothers Garcia any affiliation to the Nickelodeon show?
It's a reboot. Exactly. It's actually those kids grown now. Okay. 20 years later, and then they have kids now. It's pretty cool. We just came from, I was in Cancun filming that. It was a really cool show.
Awesome. Our worst places to film, right?
Oh, no, it was bad. No, it was bad.
No?
Bro, it was like 9 days there, and it was all monsoon the whole time.
Oh, God.
The whole time. And then the day that we were able to film outdoors, it was so humid, man. You know, they had 2 people working on me. I'm not used to that shit. You know, I'm talking about it. It's crazy, man. It's crazy. It was a good time. It's always good to be working.
Yeah, and good to work with your wife too. That's got to be kind of an interesting dynamic, right?
It's actually great, you know, because we lay down in bed at night and rehearse our scenes laying down and think about how we're gonna do it, and then when we get there, we do it a whole different way. You know what I'm talking about? And at least we know our lines, you know what I mean? And it's good because I tell her, listen, this is probably going to hurt you because I'm going to pull your hair for real. Yeah, but it's going to look great on screen. That's how I work. I want to grab you, you know, and I want to grab you, and I do, and I will grab you. Now you can grab me, you know what I mean? You know, that's okay. It's kind of good and it's bad, you know, because this is the deal. If you ever work and you're going to do a scene like that, keep it real, man, because it's going to live forever. You dig what I'm saying? So, you know, but this, the flip side, I get in trouble, not in trouble, but, you know, like they tell me, take it easy, you know. So, this little kid, you know, I was on this, I can't say those things, it hasn't come out yet. Yeah, I can't say those things. Yeah. Anyway, it was good. It was good, but then I can say one that, remember the time in Sons of Anarchy where I had put the gun in the lady's head?
Oh, yeah.
I'm looking for a son, right? And like I said, I play for real, you know, because it's better to just react than to act, you know. Well, the gun had a place for a silencer, so I didn't think about this. So I'm putting the gun to her head, and after the fourth take, I said, Emilio, you can't be doing that, bro. She has a hole in her head, you know, so I went over there, and she had an imprint of the gun in her forehead. And it's not good, because when you see it, you can't see a hole in her head before I even put the gun there, you know what I'm saying? So yeah, you know, sometimes I get carried away, you know.
Yeah, I'd be worried if someone's like, no, go ahead, you can grab them. Hey, look, it's okay.
But it's cool, and I warn them a little bit that I'm going to be a little bit rough. And I do, but I tell them be as rough as you want with me, because I mean, I've been hit before, so I'm okay, you know. You know, so I'm okay, you know? It looks great, man. You know? I remember I did a movie called High Crimes with Jim Caviezel and Ashley Judd, and we had a fight scene, and I got a cracked rib and a black eye out of it. They look good on screen, though, you know what I'm talking about?
And Jim passed out. I don't know if you guys know Jim. He played Jesus in Passion of the Christ. Jim, one of the sweetest people, right?
Yeah, but a big guy and strong, bro. Right. He's the one that told me, because you want to go for it, I go, just go for it, bro. He did. We went at it, man. He's a big dude.
Got beat up by Jesus. Man, all right. Love it. All right, do we have another one? There we go.
Yes. You guys are successful Latino actors. Mm-hmm. What does that mean to you, and how does that make you feel, man, to be successful and you know, represent La Raza?
It makes me prouder than you ever know, brother. I'm talking about, you know, and it wasn't easy. It was, and guys like, well, not Eddie. Eddie, not as much as me and Danny, but we weren't really accepted too much, bro. Mm-hmm. And that's what makes it more prouder is that, and it's got to stop now. The people, the fans and stuff have always been there for us, but in-house, you know, not so much, you know. It's because, oh, you're playing this and that, and you shouldn't be playing that. And you know, why are you auditioning for it then, bro? You know, I'm talking about, if you're telling me not to play it, then why are you sitting in the same room with me? You know what I'm saying? I think they're more pissed off because we're taking the roles and they weren't. You know what I mean? And later on, as time goes on, you can see that I was just hating. And now it's getting better, not a lot better. It could be a much more better, but. You know what, man? I just, you know, Danny, and like me and Danny, we love everybody, bro. We hope you get the role, because we're going to work anyway. You dig what I'm saying? God bless for that. But, you know, the people that want to see you not succeed are the ones that didn't succeed at all. You dig what I'm saying? So always love your fellow actor. Love your fellow man. You're going to be okay, man. You know, you can't worry about what he's doing, because then you forget about what you got to do. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. And it's so nice too that there are kids now, you know, that are watching you, and they, you know, they feel seen. They feel like, oh man, that's me. And
exactly.
That's more special than you know.
And then you can also do it as well. You know what I mean? You know, I have, because of social media, now I'm accessible to a lot of people now, to anybody. Mm-hmm. And I get so much beautiful mail, man. Like, hey, you know what, I'm an OG, blah blah blah. And my son wouldn't change, but he's only changed because of you, man. So that's beautiful. Yeah. I get so much. Some people be like, hey man, I got my 3-month chip. I said, well, let me see your 6-month chip. Same guy, he's got a 3-year chip now. Oh, and so on and so on and so on. You know, that's a blessing, bro. You know what I'm talking about? It really is, you know?
That's so cool. Yeah. So amazing. That's the best part.
It is, really is.
Yes, sir.
I'm more of a statement than more of a question. I've seen you in, you know, several different characters, and you've always shined, man.
Thank you.
I look forward to seeing. Yep. Seeing your star rise. But I do have a small question. What do you prefer, the villain or the good guy?
Always the villain, brother. You know what I'm talking about? You know, I'm a good guy in real life, man. I wasn't that guy for a long time, but you know, and I love being the nice guy. I love when you guys come up and we talk. I'll kid around with, I have some quick responses for you. But so let me, and I've got that question a few times over the years, and you know what, man? The bad guys, let me let it out. Let me have some fun, man. You dig what I'm saying? You know, I'm gonna be nice when we say cut. You know what I mean?
Oh, that's so much fun. And yes, sir.
Have you ever passed up on a role?
Excuse me?
Have you ever passed the role?
I have. I've passed on other roles. Yeah, I have. Yeah. Sometimes because they don't want to change the name of a gang, or they don't want to change the name of a club or an organization, and if they don't want to change it, I don't want to raise no eyebrows. I'm street smart. I've been in the streets for a long time, and so I know better, and they know that I know better. So it's better I don't do it. You know what I mean? It's respect, brother. You know.
Yeah. You had a question.
What memories do you have of filming Free from Hell?
Free from Hell.
The first story I said about Rob Zombie, because I was really in pain, brother. I had a real terrible motorcycle accident right before I was going to start my engine. It was bad, I went through some shit there, man. I was in a wheelchair for 3 months, and I was in a walker and all that. It was a big old process, man. They wanted to cut off my leg, and so it was. And if you see the first season of Mayans, I'm never walking. I'm always propped up or something, just because I couldn't walk. You know what I mean? Wow. Well, of course, we didn't tell nobody that, because I'm a motorcycle guy, and we're not supposed to get in accidents, right? You know what I'm saying? In the movies, you know. Yeah. So you know, so Rob Zombie, that part he gave me, that was my first job back, and so that's a job I'll always remember. And I'll always remember how he took care of me, you know what I'm saying? You know? Yeah. I'll never forget that guy. He's really cool.
Yeah, that's so cool. I think we have time for about 3 more questions. So if you've been holding it, that's it. There we go.
I know you're a big horror fan, but I'm curious. What would you be? Werewolf, zombie, or
something? Frankenstein. Yeah. I love Frankenstein.
Love to see you spank it, son. That would be, wouldn't that be great?
Yeah.
You know, I'd have to run all night. It's just going. It'd be great, right?
Easy script.
You know, Zombie, Rob Zombie is doing the monster movie.
Yeah.
He's in Hungary building that set right now. Wow. It's pretty cool.
That's going to be a fun one. Yes, sir.
Is there like a passion project or something like that that you haven't done yet that you want to venture out to? You've done.
I'm doing that right now. Actually, I'm directing a documentary right now, and it's all passion, bro. It's all because my homeboy. We ran together. We ran the streets together, and he became a fireman, lost his arm as a fireman, and became a captain. Then he went became a chief. But he had to do the whole thing like a regular guy, you know. And he's just a guy from the streets like me. We ran together. We did things together, and I think the streets set him up to be who he is today. Because he, you know, we the streets. You can't be weak. You can't be. You just go forward all the time, no matter what. And yeah, it's beautiful, man. I just shot his retirement last week. I went with the crew, shot that up, and we're cutting it up right now. So
cool.
Hopefully, get to
Netflix.
Excuse me.
I will see you soon.
Thank you.
Oh, that's gonna be amazing. Yes, sir.
I want to thank you for being here, man. And I want to thank you for all that you shared. You have a very heartwarming redemption story. Mm-hmm. And a lot of it was very personal. Like, for you to be vulnerable, like, right before us, allowed me to give you your due respect. And I love what you also said about the never quit thing, you know, never give up. Because the Honorable Sid Haig actually said something very similar. Mm-hmm. It was in one of the House of a Thousand Corpses features. And people say, you know, you're this icon, you're a legend in the industry, you've done all these things. What advice do you have to an aspiring actor or someone in the business? And he just said, never quit.
Yeah, he said the same thing again. Yeah.
So you're absolutely right. So thank you.
Yeah, man. Yeah. If I were to quit, you know, when you know, I had a lot of stuff that worked against me, like especially the way I looked, you know, had that attitude, you know. And maybe it was I put myself against me. You dig what I'm saying? And I had some great mentors over the years, you know, and sometimes I wanted to quit. You know, you get a lot of no's in this business. You really do, man. You got a lot, you know, a lot less no's now, but but like the streets, they set me up for that too. You dig what I'm saying? And it's the streets. It was that the difference about that is that I was used to, if you didn't give it to me, I'd take it. You know what I'm saying? And when I got to the business, I couldn't take no more. It's just, you have to work for it. You dig what I'm saying? And you really have to work because there's a lot of us out there. Don't quit.
Well, for yourself,
man.
We're very proud of you. You should be proud of yourself.
Thank you so much.
Absolutely. Well, who's got a good final question to close us out? Because this is the last one in Frightmare.
You turn in your jacket to be bodyguard on my end, but are you ever gonna put it back on?
I hope so.
Yeah.
I'm tired of taking orders, man. treats me like shit, right?
It doesn't even seem right that you're taking orders. Yeah.
Thank you for that. I know I didn't get it either, but you know, I gotta tell you, I can say it now, and the reason, well, I can't say that either, so no, yeah.
That's so cool. Well, one thing we've been doing in the panels that's really cool, before we close it out, before we give the big round of applause, a good Texas send-off, we're gonna take a big selfie. With everybody in the background here,
sure,
they could tag it up. Yeah, so everybody jump in this real quick, and then we're gonna give them a big round of applause, okay?